Good afternoon, everybody. And first of all, I would like to thank organizers for this very nice and interesting conference. I believe it was not that simple to organize it this time. And indeed, it's been and useful, I believe, for all of us. So, and today I would like to present you some estimations which we did for future missions here in Tübingen with Professor Andreas Santangelo, Josef Jochu, my student Charles Thorpe Morgan, who presented a poster an hour ago, so, and some other colleagues from Erlangen and Geneva University. So I will focus on missions in X-ray band, which is obviously much lower energies than we were discussing, also of Manuel and Alejandra. But still, they will be there within 10 years, and these missions are very good because they will be characterized by much higher effective area and or much broader field of view than present-day missions. So these missions will be, I hope to convince you that these missions will be well suited for such weak signal which originates from the whole field of view. And among these missions, I will briefly stop on XTP, on Athena and Theseus, which we expect to be launched between 2027 and 2032. So if we do a very simple, very naive calculation of what minimal flux can be detected within these missions, you can see that this minimal flux, it depends first of all on effective area, on the field of view of the instrument, and on the background and energy resolution of this instrument. So on this plot, approximate and close to the best, in fact, estimations can be detected by all these missions. Tommy and you see XMM. So practically all instruments from next generation missions, they will be better. And let me briefly discuss these missions. So the first one is XTP, planned to be launched in 2027. It will operate in 0.5 to 50 kV energy range. It will host four instruments, soft focusing array, large area detector, wide field monitor, and polarimetry focusing array, which probably not the best instrument for dark matter specific studies. So we'll have field of view comparable to XMM energy resolution. It will have much higher effective area, as you can see on the left in comparison to XMM. So order of magnitude higher effective area. Large area detector, it will have field of view much broader than XMM. It will have comparable, probably a bit worse energy resolution, but it will also have huge effective area. So red curve on the left panel. And the wide field monitor, it will have extremely broad field of view of two steradian scale and the energy resolution comparable to those of XMM. The price for that is that it will have very low effective area. Then next mission will be Athena, which will be ESA mission, and it was selected as a large class mission in 2014, and hopefully it will be launched in 2031. It will be really large satellite with 12 meter focus lens. It will host two instrument, wide field imager and X-ray field unit. So both of them will not have very large field of views, but all of them will have very high effective area. So you can see here that in comparison to XMM, improvement will be again factor of 10 or even 100. Then next mission will be Theseus, which was selected for assessment studies by ESA in 2018. Hopefully it will be launched in the beginning of 2030s, and it will host three instruments, SXI, XGIS, and infrared telescope, which again, we will not discuss here because in infrared, we do not have too much X-ray candidate. This mission is again characterized by extremely broad field of views of one steradian scale and relatively good energy resolution of 0% for SXI, order of 1.5% for XGIS, low energies, and about the same for XGIS-S, which will operate at higher energies. So we have these three missions, and of course, then the natural question can arise, what can or what should we observe with these missions? And as a matter of fact, many astrophysical objects cost a large amount of dark matter. And all of these objects, of course, can be used for indirect dark matter searches. And also, as a matter of fact, there is no single best target for such searches. And other considerations should be taken into account when we are selecting our objects. As we see from previous talk, galactic center, it's a good target, but also the signal from it can be spoiled from poorly known dark matter density there and high astrophysical background in that regions. And again, since before we were speaking about WIMPs, about high mass dark matter, so let me briefly introduce you to which naturally appear in the KV band. So first one is or right-handed neutrino, whose typical mass is of about 1 keV, for which we expect them to decay over a photon and the neutrino, and be dark photon, which for masses lower than electron mass can preferably decay over 3 photons. So very brief introduction to strial neutrinos. They appear as a natural extension of standard model, since in standard model all particles accept chirality. And this extension of standard model proposes right-handed companions to standard model neutrinos. Typical masses of these companions are in KV and GV band. NUMSM, this model with strial neutrino, it's nice because it's a natural standard model extension. It explains low neutrino masses via the SOM mechanism, and thus it can explain oscillations of neutrino. It can explain baryon asymmetry in the early universe. It provides a good dark matter candidate, and it also can account for some other observations, for example, detect strial neutrino decays if we observe some physical object. We expect to have a narrow line which originate from decay of strial neutrino over usual neutrino and gamma ray photon, and in this case we expect the signal to be a narrow line located at energy of half of neutrino mass with the flux corresponding to this formula. And here you see that we also have this J factor or D factor for decay dark matter, which corresponds to the total dark matter mass in the field of view. And make a short comment that why this is important, that our object with dark matter covers. Then this J factor will be still J factor of the object itself. And if we increase field of view and make it broader than the object itself, we do not benefit from it. Other way around, our limit can become worse because of increased background in this case. So it's always good to select for observations an object which is size comparable to the size of field of view. And let me briefly also stop on current limits on strial neutrino models, which originate from 3 broad classes. So first of all, these are fundamental limits like Tremaine compound, which practically say that we cannot pack too many strial neutrinos, too many fermionic dark matter into some objects like dwarf spheroidals. And from this, we have estimations for strial neutrino mass of higher or around 1 keV. It was recently in a few papers which did more precise calculations, but still it's around 1 keV. Next limits are just observational, which originates from non-detection of any line from dark matter dominated objects like dwarf spheroidals or blank sky regions. And the last class of constraints, these are constraints from early universe, which are constraints from dark matter overproduction or resonant production of dark matter, which produces light element inconsistent with BPM. So what can do next generation missions? So we propose that different strategies can be used for narrow field of view missions. Namely, we propose that narrow field of view missions serve some kind of small dark matter dominated targets, which can be, for example, dwarf spheroidals or cluster of galaxies. So again, to make size of this object, the size of the field of view of these missions. And such missions are Athena and SFA instrument from XTP. And for broad field of view missions, we propose to observe Milky Way dark matter itself. And examples for such missions can be other instruments of XTP, like LAD, like Wide Field Monitor, and TZUs, all instruments from TZUs. And as you can see on these figures, currently excluded regions are shown with shaded regions, and all these curves correspond to sensitivities of different instrument for stellar neutrino. And this black point, it present this tentative detection of 3.5 keV line in XMM in Chandra data. So if take this point seriously, if we believe in it, you see that next generation instrument will be able to detect this signal, and probably you can do even dark matter astronomy within 10 years timescale. So practically we will be able to see different signal sensors in different objects and see how it's in agreement with what we expect. Next and last dark matter candidate, which I would like to stop on, it's a dark photon. It's can be thought as a vector generalization of vector extension of the standard model. If the mass of dark photon is less than vector mass, preferably K channel is 2-3 photons. And in this case, we do not have a narrow spectral feature like for sterile neutrinos, but instead we have a broad spectral feature, relatively broad. And peculiarly, if we can observe just part of the spectral feature, it will look like for us like an object with very hard spectrum. And because of this, we can use even low energy instrument to probe higher mass dark photons. And so far, current limits, especially in the X-ray band, they originate constraints. Practically, we can produce dark photons in the stars, and this opens additional energy loss channel. And comparison to these energy losses to nuclear energy generation rate can allow us to put some constraints on dark photons. And the indirect detection, as we already saw, can be done via search broad spectral feature in blank sky region in Milky Way dark matter observations, for example. And the strongest limit is with integral P of blank sky. And as you can see, future missions, especially TZUs, will be beneficial for such observations as the energy range which covers it continues up to MeV energies and then integral P in this band for dark photons. And my last slide, it's just prospects for sterile neutrino. Yes, Moritz, I did it. And I will just would like to leave you with it and say that hopefully within 10 years we will enter dark matter astronomy era and nice large area and broad field of view missions, and we will have much improved constraints of stellar neutrino and dark photons, or we'll finally detect something. And if you are interested in more details for all these missions, please see all these papers. I will upload presentation. I will ask organizers to upload it somewhere, or and they put it to the Slack channel, so you can take a look on all these papers. So, arigato, and thank you for listening and organizing this conference.